Awakening by Solo Citizen. Chapter 6. Passacaglia in the Library. Present Day. There was no gravity. Lumina floated away from the green turf beneath her while her legs scrambled in vain to touch the ground. The warmth of the midday sun rained down on her back, and the scent of lavender sailed on the wind. The oddest part about the situation was that Lumina didn't know how she got there. She didn't gradually wake up in that mess, nor did she make any kind of transition. She was just there, in the middle of the action, like in a dream.
"Oh my, do you need my help?"
asked a voice above her, so timid and sweet she put Lumina's fears at ease.
"You should really stop fighting it and think about the ground."
She tried to turn her head to look up at the airborne creature, but she couldn't crank her head around enough to get a good look at it. Feathered wings turned the air above Lumina and fanned little gusts of wind in her direction. The more and more she thought about the creature and its voice, the more and more she drifted toward it. As she drew closer, vibrations trickled through her and shook her very core. Lumina's mind wandered into thoughts of spinning, and she started to rotate.
"Wow, what's happening?"
Lumina flailed her hooves, but they had no effect. She spun over her head and stopped facing the fluttering voice.
"What?"
A yellow Pegasus hovered above Lumina. Her mane was the softest shade of pink, and combed just the right way to hide a good portion of her face. And she was flying. Her wings were actually flapping and sustained her in the air.
"You're flying!"
Lumina gasped.
"That's not a problem, is it?"
The Pegasus started to hide behind her own forelegs.
"Well, I think it might be, seeing how ponies can't fly." If you don't mind me pointing out, you're flying right now."
Lumina glanced over at the grass beneath her.
"I'm trying not to think about that."
Lumina flicked her tail back and forth.
"Maybe you're not ready to fly yet,"
said the Pegasus.
"Maybe you should keep your hooves on the ground, at least until you get used to it. It's okay, though. I bet you'll pick it up a lot faster than I did. Try thinking about floating down until you touch the ground."
Lumina gulped, then breathed in and out, and concentrated on reversing the sensations flowing through her. She focused her thoughts on the firm earth below and didn't let her mind wander. Sure enough, Lumina started drifting toward the ground. Soon she was lying on her back with little blades of grass flicking in her ears. The Pegasus landed less than a meter away from her and loomed her bright pink and yellow head over Lumina.
"There, is that better?"
she asked Lumina.
"I think so,"
Lumina said.
"At least I'm not weightless anymore." "But you are weightless. You're just not floating right now because you told yourself not to."
Lumina ignored that last statement. Moving proved a lot more difficult than she thought. Whatever this place was, the traditional concept of locomotion didn't apply here. No matter how much Lumina commanded her body to move, it just stayed put.
"I'm afraid that doesn't work here,"
said the Pegasus.
"You have to visualize what you want to do instead of, you know, actually trying to do it. You can do it, though. Give it a try."
Lumina breathed in and created a mental image of herself standing on all fours. That time, she floated off her back and spun in the air until she completed a 180-degree arc before landing on her own hooves, just as she imagined.
"Wow!"
Lumina stared at her hoof and watched it as it rose off the ground after merely picturing it moving.
"I'm going to need to relearn the basics." "Walking and flying aren't that hard. It just takes a little getting used to."
The yellow Pegasus grinned with her eyes closed.
"You're picking things up really quick. I'm sure you'll be walking and flying around in no time."
The mind commanded the body obeyed, and that was how the body and the mind moved through the world. But not here. In order to move, the mind must command itself, but the problem was that the mind wasn't used to obeying. Stray thoughts, lack of clear visualization, and self-doubt all hindered Lumina and her early attempts at the simple act of walking. The Pegasus commented on Lumina's struggle to put one hoof in front of the other, often with reassurances such as,
"You rock!"
and,
"Way to go! Just a little more!"
or even,
"Woohoo!"
After mastering walking, Lumina took the opportunity to study her surroundings. From what she could tell, she was in a field that stretched out endlessly in every direction. She raised a hoof to shield her eyes from the midday sun and scanned the heavens. The sky overhead was full of churning clouds that flowed and swirled together and feigned the shapes of temples, of grand buildings, before dispersing and reforming again. Lumina stared directly into the sun, but instead of burning her eyes, it filled her with an intangible warmth.
The sky here is so... I don't know. There's something majestic about it.
She lowered her hoof away from her eyes.
I know, and it's amazing to fly in,
said the Pegasus.
Which is odd coming from me. I'm not exactly a very strong flyer.
A symbol on the Pegasus's flank caught Lumina's attention. She recognized it from her storybook. 3 fluttering butterflies. Fluttershy's own emblem and cutie mark. Lumina galloped alongside the Pegasus to get a clear view of her flank, then froze in shock.
Is there something wrong?
Asked the Pegasus.
You are doing really, really well. I think you've just about mastered walking, and you could probably try flying. That is, if you like.
Why is that on your flank? Lumina pointed a hoof at the 3 butterflies.
That?
The Pegasus followed Lumina's gaze to her rear.
Oh, that's my cutie mark. I forgot you've never seen one before. You see, when a pony figures out her special talent...
I know how the fairy tale goes! Lumina stomped her hooves and marched forward. Her aggressive posture and raised voice frightened the Pegasus into hiding behind her own mane and forehooves. What I want to know is why that particular symbol on your flank. Where am I? And what is going on here?
Because it's my special talent.
The Pegasus quivered with fright and lowered her voice with each word.
I'm really good with animals.
Just who are you exactly? Overcome with fright, the Pegasus couldn't meet Lumina's eyes for more than a fleeting pass, and didn't even raise her wings in a defensive stance. Instead, she backed up and quivered. If she could retreat into the earth, she would have.
My name is Fluttershy.
The Pegasus spoke just above a whisper.
But that's impossible. You're dead.
Lumina took a step back and shifted all her weight onto her hind legs. Her front hoof lifted from the ground, primed to swing to her left and propel her out of here. Fluttershy opened her mouth to speak. The vibrations flowing over Lumina took a sharp turn in frequency, and a vortex of purple light flashed into being beside her. It burst open with a snap about 5 meters away. The entire phenomenon occurred within a second. She darted back a step, but something inside her told her not to run, and she relaxed. In place of the vortex stood a purple unicorn. She held herself with confidence, well earned, and her flank was marked with a magenta star. Right away, Lumina recognized the pony.
Twilight Sparkle?
Lumina's jaw dropped, and after the initial shock wore off, her eyes found the ground, and her body language closed up.
What's wrong?
Twilight trotted forward and put a hoof on Lumina's shoulder.
I thought you'd be much happier to see us.
I am. Don't get me wrong, but this is also unexpected.
Lumina's eyes never left the turf.
You're here? Fluttershy is here? I don't know. It's too perfect. It's exactly what I would dream about if I could choose. I'm really sorry, but
I understand,
Twilight said.
Are we still, you know, friends?
Lumina forced herself to pick her head up and make eye contact with Twilight.
Of course. That will never change.
Twilight and Lumina pulled each other in for a hug, and the two held each other close before backing away. Lumina's eyes lit up. Fluttershy cantered up alongside them and pawed at the ground.
Well, unless you need me for anything else, I think I'll just be going,
she said.
Thank you, Fluttershy,
Twilight said.
I'm glad some pony was here in time to meet my friend. I'll stop by for some tea a little later.
Thank you for helping me out.
Lumina put a hoof on Fluttershy's shoulder, but the mare tensed up, and Lumina quickly put her hoof down.
Sorry.
I'm glad I could help,
said Fluttershy.
If you'll excuse me, though, Twilight has a lot to talk to you about. Also, I need to check up on another pony.
And with that, Fluttershy vanished with a snap and a flash.
That's so strange, Lumina said to Twilight. How do you ponies keep doing that? I thought only unicorns could do magic. At least that's what I always heard.
Come along, Lumina.
Twilight Sparkle motioned at a dirt path leading through the grass field.
I've got a lot I need to tell you.
Through the grass and over the trail, Twilight guided Lumina. Little bugs chirped in the grass, and the smell of flowers wafted up from the ground. A strong breeze flowed through the grass and whistled in Lumina's ear. For a brief second as it passed, she felt a tinge of weightlessness. She planted both her hooves on the ground and cast her gaze upward at the endless sky.
I know this is probably just a dream or hallucination, but I want to hear your explanation for where we are exactly, and for why you are even talking, even though you have been dead for at least 11,000 years or so,
said Lumina.
Actually, just skip it to how I can save Animus.
I'll start with why we are here first, and then work my way up to how you're going to save your friend.
Twilight dragged her eyes away from the trail every now and then to glance at Lumina, but she never slowed or paused.
Right now, we're in the magical plane. You can think of it as a physical world like the stage at a theater. The magical plane is the backstage, at least as far as you're concerned. Whenever a Pegasus walks on a cloud, or a unicorn levitates an object, or an earth pony grows a plant from a seed, they make it happen here first. The same is true for much of the mundane things, too, like writing a book or building something new. Most of the time, ponies aren't even aware that they're using the magical plane.
Just ahead of them, purple light rolled up the path and replaced the dirt trail with fresh bricks. It stopped right at Twilight's hooves. She stepped onto the bricks and continued without taking notice.
Did you just do that?
Lumina recoiled from the brick trail.
Yes, and it wasn't even that difficult,
said Twilight.
Anything you imagine becomes reality, which makes magic a whole lot easier. Any pony can fly or teleport or make their own little world just by thinking about it. Pretty neat, huh?
After testing the path with her hoof, Lumina stepped onto the bricks and caught up with Twilight.
Could I, you know, make some pony appear?
Lumina asked.
Yes, but you won't be able to interact with her.
Twilight Sparkle turned around.
At least not with your current knowledge of magic. Go ahead. I bet you know what to do.
Her mother's smile, the flicker in her eyes, and her wonderfully pink coat. Lumina closed her eyes and poured every detail she could remember about her mother into her mind's eye. And when the image was complete, that familiar tingling sensation filled her horn. When Lumina opened her eyes again, there stood her mother. Age and stress took its toll on her, but her smile and that little light in her eyes was unchanged. She was standing on her hind legs, her front hooves propped up on an invisible table, and her eyes darted across pages on an unseen book. Lumina's mother scooted down the table, picked an invisible object up in her mouth, and set it down beside her. Lumina watched, half in delight and half in sorrow.
How come I can't see any of her environment?
She asked.
Your perception alters reality. The things you want to see and what you're familiar with changes the spell,
said Twilight.
We're actually in the middle of a magical downtown Ponyville right now. You can't see it because you're not open to seeing it yet. The same goes for my wings. I was actually a princess for a while.
Is there any chance she can see me? The projection of Lumina's mother paused in her work and glanced over her shoulder. She looked to her left and aimed her gaze right at her. But only for a brief second, and then she was back to work.
Never mind. I don't need to know, said Lumina.
Dark swirls danced around the image of Lumina's mother, and then the projection flickered out. It hurt to watch, but seeing her for that fleeting minute was worth the pain. Lumina tore herself away from her thoughts of her parents and forced herself to look away.
I'm sorry, but did you just say you had wings?
Lumina raised an eyebrow and made a question gesture with her hoof.
That can't be right. There was never any mention in any of the stories that you were a princess. My point exactly.
The purple unicorn sighed and rolled her eyes.
If you've convinced yourself some pony is a unicorn, then you will never see an alicorn when you look at them. It doesn't matter too much, though, because what you think of me doesn't change who I am.
Lumina shook her head and flicked her hoof in the air as if she was shooing away a pesky bug.
We're getting off topic, she said. You said that if I came here that you would be able to tell me how to save my friend. If I don't do something quick, he's going to die. So, what do I have to do? I was never trying to keep the solution from you.
Twilight Sparkle aimed her sympathetic eyes right at Lumina.
You wouldn't be open to hearing what we had to say unless you came here first. That and my teacher wants to tell you that in person.
So, when do I get to talk to this pony? Lumina said.
Can we teleport over to her? The sooner I talk to her, the sooner I can get back to my ship and save his life.
Twilight looked straight up at the sun, without covering her eyes or squinting.
She's up there.
Twilight pointed up.
When you're ready to speak with her, start floating up to the sun. I'll be right behind you the entire time.
More floating. Lumina hated the thought, but Animus's life was on the line. With a deep breath in and a deep breath out, she closed her eyes and conjured up the sensation of ascending up and up. When she opened her eyes again, she was floating away from the ground with her legs dangling in the air. Twilight Sparkle hovered in the air beside her.
It's a great way to give flying another try, she said. I'm surprised to see you trying again so quickly.
Flying is something I don't think I can get used to, unless I'm in my ship, of course, Lumina said. If the only way to save Animus is by floating, then sign me up. I've lost a lot of ponies I cared about, and I'm not losing another. As the two mares drew closer and closer to the sun, a new high frequency of magic washed over Lumina. The sensations intensified and pulsed through her very core. The light from the sun enveloped everything in a white glare. Twilight vanished in the flare, but Lumina was still aware of her presence on an intangible level. What happened next, Lumina didn't see, smell, hear, taste, nor feel. She just experienced events using the very essence of her being. The sun opened before her like a blooming flower, and she kept pushing herself forward. The sun's petals arced over her being and joined back together. There was a geometry and an endless space ahead of her, all of which fractaled and spun and blossomed again. There was an intelligence, too, which reached out to Lumina with a welcoming intent. She accepted the invitation and allowed the boundaries of herself to blur together with the shapes and the magic around her. At that moment, she became aware that her body back in the Luna dream had toppled over. Her eyes rolled back and were fluttering open and shut. She was panting and quivering. She watched herself for a moment and then fell into the heart of the sun. The scent of old books emerged out of the flowering space and teased at her nose. Lumina's eyes darted to bookshelves on her left and right, and then down. She floated centimeters above the white floor, and with a little bit of effort she lowered herself onto all fours. She arrived in this place the same way she entered the magical plane, floating and in the middle of an action. Faint music played somewhere nearby. Violins, maybe, but it was too faint to tell.
"Hello? Twilight?"
Lumina called out. Bookshelves and white stone walls behind them reached up until they faded into the blue sky. She was in the library, just as she had envisioned as a filly, and standing there at that moment, it felt right. Actually, it was better than right. The experience was nothing short of euphoric. She was meant to stand there now, amongst the books and the sky and the music. Then she remembered her book and her vision of the place as a filly. And then her stomach turned over and her heart knotted up. She studied the place in fine detail and compared it to her memories, but in the end, Lumina failed to reach any conclusion on if the library was real or not. Embedded in the high walls were stained glass works identical to those in her storybook. They caught the sun and breathed color into the events depicted in the images, such as the banishment of Nightmare Moon and the first Discord crisis. As far as Lumina knew, these events were arranged in chronological order, and as she cantered off down the hall, she hit the fall of magic. And in the next window over, Equestria sank into the ocean. After that, centuries of war and chaos followed, and then came the advent of high technology, and the three tribes reached for the stars. Further down the Great Wall, the colonial rebellions were depicted in orange and crimson. The last 10,000 years had been bloody. No matter where Lumina wandered, the music followed her, and always just far enough away to keep the details of its melody hidden.
"She's gotta be around here somewhere."
Lumina heard Twilight's voice echo off the chamber walls, followed by the clippity-clop of hooves on stone.
"I'm really sorry about this. I didn't think I'd lose her coming up. For pony's sake, where did she go?"
"It's quite all right, Twilight Sparkle. She'll turn up soon enough,"
said a second voice Lumina recognized. Where exactly she remembered it from, she couldn't tell. It was mellow and soft, but authority hid just behind the words. A distant part of her recognized it.
"I believe she is listening to us as we speak."
"Hey, I'm over here!"
Lumina shouted. She tried to leap above the bookshelves to get a glimpse of the other pony, but didn't catch any more than the sight of more bookshelves. The hoof step stopped, and when she checked around the next corner, the most radiant pony she had ever seen stood tall before her. She was both a Pegasus and a unicorn. Only three ponies in Lumina's storybook had both a unicorn's horn and the wings of a Pegasus. Even when her perfect white coat and her Aurora mane wasn't taken into account, the way she held herself with overwhelming authority softened by benevolence and wisdom quickly eliminated the other two princesses. Princess Celestia, the ruler of Equestria, and the harbinger of the sun. Every fairy tale and bedtime story Lumina ever heard referenced her in one way or another. She stepped back and gasped in awe. She was also a great deal taller and larger than any pony Lumina had ever met.
enjoying my library?
Celestia asked.
You're Princess Celestia!
Lumina looked her up and down.
You're a lot bigger than I imagined.
Twilight Sparkle popped out from around a bookshelf behind Celestia. She bit her lower lip and shook her head at the words.
I haven't heard that one in a long time.
Princess Celestia laughed a little, and Twilight sighed in relief.
It's so lovely to finally meet you in person. My faithful student, Twilight, was not sure if you were able to come here, but I had confidence in your ability to reach this place.
My abilities? Lumina asked.
Are you sure you're not confusing me with some pony else? I'm the most unmagical unicorn you could find. And I'm still on the fence if magic is even real or not.
You shouldn't dismiss your talent so easily.
Celestia motioned for Lumina to follow her. Lumina and Twilight obliged.
You see, I've been watching you very closely. Ever since you were very small. I know about how you started mastering levitation when you were just a foal. And I know about how your talents led to therapy that sealed off your magical side.
I don't blame any psychiatrist for anything in my life,
said Lumina.
I used to, at one point, but not anymore.
And neither do I.
Celestia ruffled her feathered wings and led the other two ponies through an intersection.
Therapy helps millions of ponies deal with the struggles of this era, but that wasn't what you needed to take advantage of the moment. Simply put, it wasn't an experience that you wanted.
I'm sorry, but how do you know?
Lumina put her hoof down, forcing the other two ponies to stop.
I get Twilight. She's had a backdoor into my head since forever, but I don't understand how you know. Has Twilight been writing letters about me?
I'm surprised you didn't explain me away as part of your subconscious, and naturally privy to such information,
said the princess. Lumina opened her mouth and started gesturing with her hoof, but then stopped in mid-motion and furrowed her eyebrows at the floor. Celestia smiled slightly.
I guess I wanted to hear my subconscious justify itself,
Lumina said.
During my time as ruler, my most important station was watching over my little ponies. Although I couldn't intervene in the lives of each of my subjects, I would have spent the entirety of my days helping each of them if I could. After my reign came to an end, I was put in charge of keeping this library, and from here I continued my role as guardian. I watched the lives of every mare, stallion, and foal unfold before me. Each one is worth protecting. But I've also been watching for ponies such as yourself, those with the capacity to fill some very important roles.
A bird called from far across the library, and Lumina glanced in its direction to try and snag a glimpse of it, but saw nothing. She spotted a leather-bound edition of Abel's Island resting atop a bookshelf.
Have you really?
Lumina pawed at the ground with a hoof, then raised her head and narrowed her eyes at Celestia.
I mean, you say you've been watching us and acting like some sort of protector, but you don't even know what's going on in the galaxy today? Arian is occupied by the Pegasus Empire. Our homeworld burns. The Griffin race is shattered, and three pony tribes are fighting at war that claims thousands of lives every day. You say that you're a magical guardian, but I say that you're not doing your job at all. Lumina!
Twilight gasped and galloped over to her.
What are you thinking? You can't talk to the princess like that. I'm thinking about how I watched my world die, and Pony Kai may be coming to an end. But I will die on a discord-forsaken ball of ice long before then.
Lumina stomped a hoof.
Twilight Sparkle, she has every right to be upset.
Princess Celestia raised her voice, but only ever so slightly.
The truth is, Lumina is correct. In many ways, I am powerless to prevent the suffering that has fallen on Ponykind. As Twilight Sparkle said earlier, the magical realm is only a backstage. The healing of the galaxy, if it is to be done at all, must be done in the physical realm. The most I can do is nudge ponies into waking up to the magic of friendship and to expedite the arrival of ponies such as yourself. There is a plan in motion, but I cannot execute it.
There you go again, implying I'm something special.
Lumina turned her back on Princess Celestia and Twilight. Her eyes found the floor.
Crazy, most likely. Special? Not in particular. I thought flying starships was my thing, something I was cut out for. But just look how that turned out.
She kept her eyes low and kicked at the floor with a hoof.
Whatever plan you have worked out, I don't think I'd be able to help. I can't even help myself or the few ponies close to me. What were you expecting me to do anyway?
Lumina circled back around to face the princess.
Like what? Were you expecting me to be an element of harmony or something?
Neither Princess Celestia nor her faithful student spoke, but Twilight's eyes widened and her ears shot up in excitement. Celestia tilted her head inquisitively.
What?
Lamina backed up and shook her head at the alicorn in front of her.
No. You must have made some kind of mistake. I am not the bearer of an element of harmony. I lie, I'm mean, I'm not exactly loyal or an optimist, and I'm not any more generous than the next pony. Unless I'm not any one of those, but that would make me...
Twilight Sparkle threatened to grin.
No, I am definitely not the embodiment of magic. That's impossible.
Lumina tried to laugh, but a nervous heart rising through her prevented the chuckle from escaping.
For starters, magic isn't real.
You are special, but not more so than any pony else,
said Celestia. We all make choices about who we are, and a very important one is ahead of you.
I'm not saying if magic is or isn't real. I also never said that you were an element. That was entirely your idea, and a choice that has presented itself to you. I have a question for you, Lumina. Do you have enough self-love to truly listen to yourself and figure out what you think on those matters? Or are you waiting for some pony to figure those out for you? Lumina, are you the element of magic, or aren't you?
I don't know!
Lumina backed away and raised her front hoof to turn and run. The heat building in her brought her ears to an uncomfortable temperature. Her careful breathing devolved into erratic panting.
I just don't know!
Lumina spun away from the two ponies and galloped down the library aisle. A short distance away, she found an alcove in the wall and collapsed into a little ball. She traced the grooves in the floor with a hoof and absent eyes. The other two ponies showed up later.
I'm not an ideal pony. I'm not some paragon of pony kind,
she said.
I don't think I'm the mare for this job. Last week I tried so hard to change, but today I nearly killed an alien out of spite. I can't believe I almost did that to another sentient being. I just don't know if I can let go. That, and I don't know the first thing about magic. I don't even have a cutie mark. I'm not the kind of pony that can take on an entire galaxy.
Twilight Sparkle sat down next to Lumina and wrapped a front leg over her shoulder. She looked up at her.
All we want from you is to be yourself,
Twilight said.
We're not asking you to change overnight. In fact, we're not even asking you to change at all. Follow your heart. Know yourself and love yourself. That's all we want from you. The best thing you can do to help the galaxy are those simple things.
And you will not be without friends.
Celestia lay down on her legs right next to Lumina. Even at this level, she towered above Lumina and Twilight.
I will provide whatever assistance I can. And I know my student will do everything in her power to help. Your mother, your father, your friends on Arion, and that computer living in your ship are all cheering you on. You also have 5 of the best friends any pony could ask for waiting for you in known space. The hardest task ahead of you is embracing who you are. Once you've done that, the rest will fall into place.
The sun over the library set, and once the last of its light trickled out, the sky gave birth to millions upon millions of tiny lights. So many stars filled the sky that they lit up the library and illuminated the stained glass. A breeze moved through the library, carrying the scent of old books.
The crazy thing is, the idea that I'm an element of harmony doesn't sound so insane.
Lumina picked herself up off the floor.
Maybe this is what I'm supposed to do. I don't know. I want to believe that I could be that kind of pony. But when I tried to grow and forgive and let go, something little got in the way and I couldn't do it. Why did all this happen now, right after everything fell to pieces?
Nothing happens before it's ready,
said Celestia.
That's just the way it is.
Keeping her head low, Lumina pulled herself off the floor and paced to and fro between the bookshelves. She looked to her hooves, then at Celestia, and then to Twilight, before finally turning her eyes back to her hooves. Lumina breathed in and exhaled.
I don't want to run away from myself anymore.
Lumina pulled her eyes from the floor and met Celestia's gaze.
If that's all I have to do, then yes, I'll be the element of magic. That is a decision about who you are only you can make.
Celestia rose up, unfurled her wings, and nodded at a point further down the library.
I am glad that you are finally starting to listen to yourself. Now, there is a matter of your friend, Animus, and your way home. That is why you came here, is it not?
A sharp pain shot through Lumina's heart and forced the air out of her lungs. She gasped for breath and clutched at her chest. The pain spread outwards throughout her whole body, and she clamped her eyes shut. The pain faded, and Lumina relaxed and opened her eyes.
"Are you all right, Lumina?"
Princess Celestia asked.
"Yeah, I'm okay."
She set her hooves down, straightened up, and held her head up.
"I think I'm going to be okay."
Lumina and Twilight followed Celestia through the library to a circular clearing. A looking glass, filled to the edge with water, rested mid-air in the center of the clearing. Celestia turned her gaze to a scroll tucked away on a bookshelf as a yellow light enveloped both her horn and the scroll, and it rose from its place and floated towards Celestia in an elegant motion. She stood before the looking glass, with the scroll unwound as it hovered in the air in front of her.
"This library has many names and many keepers,"
she said.
"A copy of every book ever written, and every book never written, is contained here along with a record of every moment experienced in history. Both of what has occurred and what has yet to come."
The symbols on the scroll didn't match anything Lumina had ever seen. They looked, well, alien. They glowed a bright yellow, and with a nod from Celestia, they swayed off the parchment and drifted into the water.
"Millions of years ago, the world you crashed on was home to two great tribes."
As Celestia spoke, the water rippled, and the image in the looking glass morphed into scenes of mighty cities adrift upon an endless ocean. Lumina sniffed and took in the scent of sea air.
"They were called the Nasharis and the Nashto, and they were the creators and the created. For a long time, there was peace between the two."
Red light flashed across the looking glass, and the sprawling ocean cities were replaced with broken ruins consumed in fire. Aircraft filled the sky and rained metal down on figures scrambling for cover. Fumes from the fires mixed with the salt in the air.
"The harmony did not last, and war engulfed both tribes. They battled for resources, over ideologies, and for no other reason than they were different. There was no room for friendship in any of their hearts."
The entire looking glass flared yellow, and the boom and rumbling of an explosion followed. When the glare cleared, mushroom clouds dotted the ocean.
"In time, they resorted to the most desperate of measures to destroy one another, and their planet was lost. It froze to death under a cloud of ash. However, there were those who saw the end coming and made preparations to begin life again after the fallout."
Now the looking glass showed the latticework ceiling in the alien ruin. Pale light filtered down from the gaps in the metal canopy and lit the way for hundreds of machines that slithered, crawled, and strode along the floor.
"They built it knowing that their oceans would freeze under the cloud,"
said Celestia.
"They hoped that someday after the skies cleared and the radiation dissipated, someone would use it to breathe life back into their planet. It was designed to warm the oceans and send trillions of tiny plants and animals into the air. And then they even left the Sentinel behind to wait for the perfect day to use their machine."
"That's the centipede, isn't it?"
Lumina asked.
"So if that's the all-wise and benevolent guard of this big terraforming engine, why did it try to kill me?"
"For the past 4 million years, she's been feasting on the memories of those that died in the war, and she's been reliving those events all this time. She doesn't trust organics anymore, and doesn't want to see them growing on the surface again."
"But you can restore her with a memory spell."
Twilight stepped around the other side of the looking glass and propped herself up on her hind legs.
"Once you do that, she'll be her old self again, in no time. And I had to do this to my friends once, so I can show you how it's done."
"Okay, but how does any of this help me save my friend?"
Lumina asked.
"The machines that built this device also included a brief record of their civilization,"
said Twilight.
"Which so happens to include a vault filled with spare robots. Each is as blank as a fresh sheet of paper. With the Sentinel's help, you can download Animus into one of those."
Lumina tried to imagine him as a giant centipede, and shivered at the thought. However, it still sounded a lot better than him dying.
"You have to understand, bringing life back to this world is the single most important thing you will ever do."
Celestia flapped her wings.
"The tasks ahead of you as an element of harmony are important, but they will never rival the importance of seeding this world with life. One day, civilization will crawl out of the oceans of this world and build cities that will span the stars. Long before my reign, unicorns like yourself raised and lowered the sun. The sun must shine on this world again, and it is well within your power to bring its warmth."
"I'm not sure if I can do that,"
Lumina gazed down into the looking glass.
I'm terrified of running into that thing again. Not just because it's the most terrifying thing I've ever seen, but also because of what I might do. Earlier today I tried to kill it, but not because my life was in danger. I was just angry and wanted it dead. What if I do something like that again?
You will have to trust yourself to make the right decision.
Celestia extended her wings and gave Lumina a warm grin.
I have every confidence that you will when the time comes.
The image in the looking glass faded back to light reflecting off water, and the words from the scroll ascended up from the water and reattached themselves to the scroll. Celestia rolled the scroll back up and deposited it back into the bookshelf.
Unfortunately, time does not permit us to continue our conversation.
Celestia flapped her wings in quick succession.
I must attend to matters elsewhere, and you have a friend that needs your help. It was lovely meeting you. Feel free to stop by any time.
Wait, what?
Lumina took a few quick steps forward.
I'm not going anywhere. Not until you tell me how to get my spaceship back in the sky. And what about the other elements? How do I find them? Don't I need a cutie mark before I try anything magical? Isn't that the way the legend goes?
I'm sorry, but no pony gets all the answers all at once,
said Celestia.
For the rest of those, you'll just have to wait and find out for yourself. I must warn you, though, there are those out there who do not wish to see the elements return, and they will do everything in their power to prevent it.
That ship that attacked the Luna Dream, it's coming back for me, isn't it?
I won't shield you from the truth. They are an ancient foe, and you will see a lot more of them in the years to come.
I'm not going to try and hide it,
Lumina said.
If they come back, I don't know what I'll do. Animus and I were completely defenseless against them when they showed up last time. I don't think we can survive another attack.
Celestia ruffled her wings and raised her head.
The assistance we are able to provide is quite limited,
she said.
I can only do for you what I can do for any pony who consents to my aid and who can open themselves enough to receive it. However, I will intervene on your behalf once, and only once. After that, you will be expected to climb your hurdles without my intervention. Now, you must go.
Oh, and you'll need this.
Twilight Sparkle levitated a scroll off a bookshelf and thrust it into Lumina's hooves.
I'll be there for you anytime you need me. Just go easy on yourself from now on, okay?
She gave Lumina a little hug and took her place by Celestia's side. Lumina kept her eyes on Twilight, but then she started shifting upwards. When Lumina looked down, her hind legs were sinking into the floor. The vibrations that pulsed against her climbed down in frequency, and when her torso reached the stone, the weight of it crushed and remolded Lumina's form. She clung to the scroll in her hooves, breathed deep, and let the floor pull her the rest of the way down. Her horn was the last part of her to remain in Celestia's library, and when it descended into the stone, she plummeted down, through the darkness of her eyes and into some confining space.
Thank you, Twilight, she remembered thinking. Thank you for everything.
Something cold pressed against Lumina, and when she opened her eyes to meet it, her vision blurred metal grating and electronics together. Lumina picked herself up off the grated floor. It left an impression on her chest and face. The space in her heart ached a little, but the pain subsided. Her body felt as heavy and unwieldy as a starship. Cold sweat covered every centimeter of her. The music that played during Lumina's time in Celestia's library was gone. She was back on the Luna Dream, in the AI core room, just as she had left herself. The vibrations of magic never completely vanished. They persisted and trickled in through her horn and filled the rest of her body. Lumina glanced at her flank. Still no cutie mark or anything else to prove her journey, for that matter. Damn. Lights below her flashed. It was a warning light on Animus's computer core. Lumina galloped out of the AI core and towards the nearest equipment locker. She had work to do.
44th of Growing Season, 10,053 AC.
A clock tick-tick-ticked away while Lumina fought the urge to tap her leg and bite her hoof. The mare, perusing her resume, flipped through the pages with the slightest hint of disgust. A frown curled across her face, and that was all it took to send Lumina over the edge to start tapping her hoof. She didn't even try keeping rhythm with the clock. The wall behind Harmony Treasure, an aging unicorn in charge of pony resources at the Interstellar Express, was plastered with a myriad of degrees and awards. The window in Harmony Treasure's office offered a view of the sprawling Celestia City, while photos of CEOs and politicians occupied the free spaces of her desk.
"Do you have any questions about my resume?"
Lumina asked.
No.
Harmony Treasure flipped back to the previous page and shook her head.
I'll let you know if I have any.
Lumina looked out the window and studied the city below. Living in tunnels and towers the last 2 years had managed to cure any claustrophobia she had, rid her body of its dependence on the sun and moon to judge day and night, and acclimate to an artificial summer all year long. The only thing that still bothered her after all this time was the fact that half the city hung from the cavern ceiling. When she looked out, she looked down. Lumina didn't even acknowledge the fact that she was in the hanging tower, or that the sky above her was a network of spires and walkways. No pony ever fell from the upper city, but Lumina was still convinced it was possible.
I'm going to be honest with you, Miss Spectre. This is the most disappointing thing I've read all week.
Harmony Treasure plopped the resume down on her desk, and Lumina snapped out of the city gazing.
You would make a fantastic pilot. Your math scores are in the 99th percentile. You managed to get licensed as a shuttlecraft pilot before you completed general schooling, and you came highly recommended by a pilot of ours.
Excuse me, but it's Lumina, not Miss Spectre.
Lumina didn't care if she was about to blow this interview or not. That mare was going to get her name right.
Sorry, please go on.
Harmony Treasure slacked her jaw a little, then raised her eyebrows and leaned back in her chair.
The fact of the matter is, Lumina, we still can't take you, she said, for two reasons. First, we do not employ pilots with a history of mental illness, and second, one of our sibling corporations would lose one of its head engineers if we did. I'm sure you're already aware that your father threatened to quit if we took you on.
Stammering, with her eyes flashing between the window and the mare behind the desk, Lumina paused to readjust herself and think through a response.
Did you read the part about how I'm cured, and how about your own psychologist examined and cleared me to fly?
Lumina started to climb out of her chair, but then pushed herself back in.
And my father? Well, if there were such thing as cutie marks, his would be a starship schematic. He won't quit. He can't. It's his calling.
The clock chirped once, then ticked away. Harmony flipped through the resume on her desk once again and glanced at the clock.
I suppose we can put you through the rest of the selection process, said Harmony Treasure. You'd be surprised how many applicants either disqualify themselves or withdraw after the AI compatibility screening. Are you free for the next 8 hours?
I think so.
Lumina's father would murder her if she weren't home in an hour.
Yes, I'm free. And if I pass your test, do I get to be a pilot?
It will help your case and mine if my boss decides to reprimand me for letting you get this far.
Harmony Treasure hopped out of her chair and opened the door to her office.
Right this way. The sooner we get started, the better.
Jagged walls, hexagonal rooms, and artificially grown crystals filled the Interstellar Express Tower. It was designed to capture the sturdy and regal architecture common in the ancient Crystal Empire, and it succeeded. Past all the fancy hallways and offices, the architecture gave way to something much more utilitarian. Harmony Treasure led Lumina into a room that made no attempt at invoking regality. Its only purpose was to house a row of computer terminals and a vault at the other end. A unicorn and earth pony wearing lab coats played around with holograms above their workstations and only paused briefly to greet Harmony and Lumina.
Hello, Harmony. What can we do for you?
The earth pony said.
I was wondering if you colts were still running tests today.
Harmony waved a hoof at Lumina and presented her to the two ponies.
I have a potential pilot that needs to find out if she can work with an AI.
My shift just started.
The earth pony gestured with his head at a hologram and the projection vanished.
I can see her through the entire test.
He turned to Lumina and said,
If you become a pilot, you're going to spend most of your career in deep space. Your only contact for months, sometimes even years at a time, will be with an AI, so it's important to know if you can handle interacting with one for an extended period of time. We can usually tell if you're cut out for the job after 8 hours.
You still want to do this?
Harmony Treasure asked Lumina.
It's not too late to back out.
Well, if that's what I have to do to pilot a starship, then yes, I'll do it.
The unicorn reopened his holographic display and started dragging and dropping symbols in the air. After some coercion, the hologram flashed green, and the vault at the far end of the room hissed open.
If you fall asleep in there or threaten the AI, you're disqualified, said the unicorn. Other than that, there's nothing you can do to instantly fail the test. The computer in there is called Animus, and he plays a wicked game of chess. Once you step inside, we'll lock the door behind you, and we can begin. You might want to use the restroom, said Harmony Treasure. You're not going to get another chance for another 8 hours.
I think I'll be fine.
Lumina peeked into the test chamber and saw nothing but whitewashed walls, a table, a couch, and a chess set. At the gesture of the lead lab pony, Lumina stepped inside, and the door sealed behind her. She scrutinized the test chamber, but didn't find any speakers or cameras.
"Hello, I'm Lumina,"
she said, but to what she didn't know.
"It is good to meet you, Lumina,"
a voice without inflection spoke from all around her. It belonged to a male, but it didn't betray any emotion.
"My name is Animus."
"It's a pleasure to meet you."
And she meant it.
"So, tell me a little bit about yourself."
Before Harmony Treasure even received Lumina's resume, her boss warned her that if she did not turn that interview away the instant she stepped through that door, she'd spend the rest of her career in the mailroom. Instead, she made the mistake of humoring Lumina's application. The Interstellar Express lost more pilots than they were training year after year. As the director of Pony Resources, she was responsible for finding well-qualified pilots and putting them at the helm of an FTL ship. And Lumina was, by definition, a well-qualified pilot. Harmony Treasure prayed to Celestia that when she returned to the AI test chamber that the ponies down there would have disqualified her. When she opened the door to their lab 8 hours later, the lead lab pony stopped jiggling his holograms and dismissed them with a single flick and said, "We need her."
"What? I was hoping you two had gotten rid of her by now."
Harmony Treasure's eyes clenched shut.
"Is she really that good?" "She's not, but they are,"
the other pony said.
"Animus and Lumina Spectre are unlike any AI pony pairing I've ever seen. By now, most subjects develop resentment towards the AI, but not her. She actually enjoys spending time with the AI, and so does it. They get along like old friends. We need to put Lumina and Animus on a ship together." "What about her psychological condition?"
said Harmony Treasure.
"Haven't you found any signs of mental instability?"
The Earth Pony brought up his hologram again and checked through his notes. After a moment, he dismissed them again. "If she has a mental illness, it hasn't manifested," he said. "From what I can tell, Lumina is a perfectly healthy pony. She has a bit of a temper, but nothing that Animus can't deal with, and there's no reason why we shouldn't hire her immediately." Good pilots were invaluable to Interstellar Express, and unfortunately, good pilots were very hard to come by. Harmony sighed. She was going to the mailroom after this.
"Get her out of there," said Harmony Treasure. "I'll tell her she's got the job."
The unicorn stabbed a holographic symbol, and a buzzer rang. With that, the vault door opened, and there was Lumina, lying on her stomach and talking about nothing in particular.
"Well, I never really thought about it,"
Lumina said to Animus. "I guess it's supposed to be artistic, but I never got it."
"Perhaps no pony understands the phenomena,"
said Animus.
"Images of ponies and socks have decreased by 33% over the last 2 years. It is a subject on the decline in most artistic circles."
Lumina spied Harmony Treasure in the doorway and got back on her hooves.
"Hi, Harmony Treasure. Is my time up?"
"The two of you are hired," said Harmony Treasure. "Lumina, you start training tomorrow at 8 a.m. Don't be late."
A smile extended from ear to ear over Lumina's face, and her eyes widened. She jumped up and down and clapped her hooves together.
"Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you!"
Lumina darted over to Harmony Treasure and shook her hoof.
"Thank you so much!"
"Don't mention it,"
Harmony Treasure sighed.
"No, really, please don't mention it."
Okay, sure, you're the boss."
Lumina cantered back into the test chamber and stared up at the ceiling.
"I have to go now, but I'll see you again tomorrow, okay?"
"Lumina?"
"Yeah, what is it?"
"I believe that you and I are going to be friends."
She gave Animus a sideways smile and tilted her head just a little.
"You mean we aren't already?"
Lumina backed out of the test chamber, but not before adding,
"See you tomorrow, Animus."
"And you as well, my friend."